You're listening to the audio production of Murder Bears, Moonshine, and Mayhem. Strange stories from the Bible to leave you amused, bemused, and hopefully informed. By Luke T. Harrington. Published by Thomas Nelson and read by Jakob Lewis.
For my dad, who taught me to love terrible jokes. And also the Bible, I guess. Of making many books there is no end, and much study is a weariness of the flesh. Ecclesiastes chapter 12, verse 12b. Buy my book! Buy my book! J. Sherman, The Critic. Introduction. I was a teenage PK. I'm going to open this book with a memory. I'm probably about 10 years old, sitting on my father's lap in the glow of a small, yellowing floor lamp that fights hard against the setting sun. He smells like coffee, and his voice is warm gravel. He's reading to me. He went up from there to Bethel, and while he was going up on the way, some small boys came out of the city and jeered at him, saying, "Go up, you bald head! Go up, you bald head!" And he turned around, and when he saw them, he cursed them in the name of the Lord. And two she-bears came out of the woods and tore 42 of the boys. 2 Kings chapter 2, 23 through 24. And I'm thinking, I just found my life verse. If you don't know what a life verse is, ask an evangelical friend to explain it to you. This book is something of a story, and that story begins with my father. My father is a pastor. Actually, it would be more accurate to say that he's a minister. He's ordained for ministry in a tiny Presbyterian denomination. But except for a handful of years when I was a kid, he's never actually pastored a church. It's possible that a pulpit gig would come with a bit more prestige, but my dad's never really been interested in prestige. Nor have I, which is why I'm sitting here writing a book on the butt jokes in the Bible. Instead, he's devoted his life to student ministry, spending his days drinking coffee and chatting about Christianity with international students at my own alma mater, the University of Nebraska-Lincoln. He's also, as you might imagine a minister to be, fairly passionate about the Bible. I'm not sure if it was he or my mother who instituted nightly Bible stories when I was a kid. But I do remember that he had a unique way of defending them when we began to complain, as we inevitably did. "Ugh, Dad," we'd say, because it was the totally radical 90s and all the cool kids talked like this. "The Bible is so boring." Given how saccharine the average children's Bible storybook is, we weren't exactly wrong to feel this way. In the face of such whining, a lesser parent would have given up or announced, "Too bad, we're doing this anyway," or thundered, "How dare you say that about the word of the Lord," and then chained us to our beds like a Stephen King villain. My dad, however, took our complaints as a challenge. "The Bible is boring, eh?" he'd say. "Is this boring?" And he would crack open the Bible to a story about kids getting mauled by bears, or a concubine getting diced up, or a prophet baking poop bread. Then, having been thoroughly traumatized, we would all be forced to admit that the Bible is many things, but it is not boring. As it turns out, there's a lot of weird stuff in the Bible. Grisly violence, depraved sex acts, poop jokes, so many poop jokes, even a handful of verses that Calvinists like. If we're being honest with ourselves, though, is it that surprising to see weird stuff in the Bible? After all, everything is weird to someone, somewhere. What people consider weird is almost entirely determined by their culture. And brace yourself, it turns out the Bible comes from a culture different from our own. Actually, multiple cultures over thousands of years. Contrary to common belief, the world was not a stodgy monolith prior to 1960. To the sufficiently narrow-minded, everything is weird. And hey, good for them, because they get to giggle a lot. This book is for those people, the ones who never get tired of giggling about poop, especially when it's mentioned in the Bible. I wrote it because I like the Bible, and because I like giggling about poop. I want to be clear, though, that I did not write it for either of the following reasons. Number one, to ridicule the Bible. After all, ridiculing things is easy. You take something out of context or paraphrase it badly, and then you wiggle your eyebrows at the peanut gallery. It can be fun, but it's also lazy and it's ultimately pointless. After all, even if you hate the Bible, it's not going anywhere. So if you're looking for mockery, go look somewhere else. I recommend the Skeptic's Annotated Bible, which is basically what you'd get if you gave a Bible and a Sharpie to Beavis and Butthead. Number two, to defend or apologize for the Bible. I think we've probably all met the pew fillers who will frown on going to an R-rated film, but will insist it's totally different when the Bible contains explicit material. You're taking that out of context, they'll say, oblivious to the fact that films also have contexts. I have no desire to be one of those people either. They're often just as obnoxious as the ridicule the Bible set. In short, I think the material here is capable of speaking for itself.
So why'd you write a book on it then, Luke?
Because this way, I get paid. There's an old quote from 19th century preacher Charles Spurgeon about how defending scripture is like defending a lion. You don't have to. You let it out of its cage and it defends itself. I think he was probably right. Despite the best efforts of many over the centuries to soften, censor, or ridicule the Bible, it remains a book that billions have read and found profound meaning in. In other words, it's not a book that everyone likes, but it's clearly doing something right. I really don't have an agenda with this book other than to encourage you to consider what that something might be. And yes, part of that something is probably poop jokes. I'm mostly serious about this. If you believe, as I do, that the Bible is God's message for all of humanity, then it makes sense that it would have something in it for everyone. Not just the overeducated theologians or the prudish old ladies or the creepy homeschool kids working the Chick-fil-A counter. It's also for the lowbrow types. The poor, the oppressed, the broken. If you believe the stuff that Jesus and the prophets said, it's actually mostly for that crowd. So yeah, it will have poop jokes. The best poop jokes. Divine poop jokes. It's been my experience that nearly everyone has a very strong opinion about the Bible. What it is, what it means, what we should all think of it. But polls show that something in the neighborhood of 80% of people will admit to never having read the whole thing. What if we all stopped forming opinions about the Bible for a second and just read it? So let's read it, starting with the poop jokes.
I mean, obviously.
I hope you enjoy this book. I hope it makes you laugh, and I hope you learn something. And I hope it inspires you to pick up a Bible. But most of all, I hope you'll join me in that chair in my bedroom on my father's lap. But not in a weird way. Mouth agape at the secret, strange riches the ancient scriptures have to offer. Chapter 1. I like biblical butts and I cannot lie. Butts, poop, and more. Whenever the existence of God is debated,
John Duns Scotus, Thomas Aquinas, and others have actually argued that it's a category error to say that God exists, since God transcends existence and all existence flows from him, but you know what I mean.
There's an old argument that keeps coming up on the pro side, called the teleological argument. Proposed and developed by such great minds as Socrates, St. Thomas Aquinas, and Kirk Cameron. Two out of three ain't bad. The argument at its core is this. Everything in nature appears to serve a clear purpose. Therefore, it must be designed for that purpose. Therefore, there must be a designer.
See Xenophon Memorabilia 1.4, Thomas Aquinas Summa Theologica 1.2.3, and then Google Kirk Cameron banana argument.
Boom, God exists. An open and shut case, right? Haha, no, of course not, because the teleological argument, for all its insight, overlooks a rather obvious question. Does everything in nature serve a clear purpose? Not only is nature itself evidently purposeless, but it has all sorts of features that seem to serve no purpose at all, like the human appendix, male nipples, and light jazz music. All too often, the believer will think he has his skeptical opponent on the ropes only for said skeptic to bust out an anatomy textbook, or flip the radio over to Smooth Sounds 103, thus rendering the believer defenseless. It occurs to me, though, that there's a fairly obvious response to this challenge that goes woefully underused. Maybe God just has a sense of humor. There's no reason we have to imagine God as an obsessive engineer fine-tuning the universe into some sort of hyper-efficient machine, designed to do what exactly? Maybe the big guy is also part comedian, filling the earth and the cosmos with things that serve no purpose at all, other than to be hilarious. Would you want to live in a world where something as entertaining as a light jazz saxophonist with saggy man nipples and an exploding appendix could exist? I know I wouldn't. Which brings me to butts. After all, what purpose does the human butt serve, aside from being hilarious and helping us look sporty in G-strings? Yes, Neil deGrasse Tyson, we're aware that defecation rids the body of toxins and the gluteal muscles are necessary for locomotion, but doesn't it say something that our bodies accomplish those things with a device as hilarious as a butt? That we all walk around with a little perpetual comedy machine attached to our bodies, just waiting to inject some hilarity into life with a well-timed fart or an accidental mooning? I already know what you're going to say. Obviously, any reasonable person would find a butt hilarious, but how can we possibly know God does? Your addition to the teleological argument is absurd, and you'll die sad and alone. Well, first off, that was hurtful. And second, if you doubt that God finds butts funny, all you have to do is read his book. What's funny is, of course, always in the eye of the beholder. But you don't have to look far in the Bible before you come across an arguably hilarious instance of a butt. Or some poop. Or a butt making poop. For instance, David to Saul. I saw your butt making poop. Everyone knows the story of David and Goliath, but if you've spent much time reading the Bible, you also know David is one of the Old Testament's A-listers, with countless adventures that sprawl across multiple books. Unlike the Goliath narrative, though, many of these stories are less than Sunday school ready. And yes, many of them involve poop. There's a rivalry in 1 Samuel between David and King Saul. But it's only a rivalry in the sense that the Lakers and the Clippers have a rivalry. That is to say, only one of them knows about it. Saul is Israel's king, and David is the God and country boy scout type who just wants to do whatever he can to support his monarch and his motherland. Unfortunately for David, Saul is a relentlessly paranoid politician who's convinced everyone else in the room is out to usurp his throne. This is particularly bad news for David, who, as Saul's court musician, not only frequently finds himself in the same room as Saul, but has also been prophesied to usurp Saul's throne. This all leads Saul to fly into a murderous rage and start chasing David through the countryside. Actually, that happens multiple times. It's a thing. At one point, David and his men get tired of all this running for their lives stuff and decide to hide in a cave for a while. Unfortunately, Saul has the same idea. Well, sort of. And he came to the sheepcotes by the way, where was a cave, and Saul went in to cover his feet, and David and his men remained in the sides of the cave. 1 Samuel 24:3, King James Version. I'm going to be using the English Standard Version of the Bible for most of this book, but here I went with the King James because it uses a more literal translation of the original Hebrew, which, as is frequently the case, is charmingly euphemistic. For the moment, ignore the part about sheepcoats, which I believe are stylish jackets for the discerning ovine gentleman. What I want to talk about is the phrase, cover his feet. To cover your feet means exactly what it says. It means you're covering your feet with your pants because you're pooping. So David and his men are hiding in the back of the cave. Saul comes in and fails to notice them. And then David and friends are trapped in the shadows watching Saul take a dump. It's an image that's difficult to get out of your mind, no matter how much bleach you pour into your eyes. Insert obligatory legal disclaimer here. But the upside for David is that he's literally caught his mortal enemy with his pants down, as his men helpfully point out. And the men of David said to him,
Here is the day of which the Lord said to you, Behold, I will give your enemy into your hand, and you shall do to him as it shall seem good to you.
Verse 4a. It's a little hard to think of something more embarrassing than being killed by the guy you were trying to kill while you were in the middle of pooping.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.